Colossians 1, 15 through 17. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things consist.
I wanted to begin with a brief story this morning in regards to, and I have to apologize that some of the details are a little bit, they're going to be a little bit vague and ambiguous, but I can promise you, you can look up the story and it's true. So we'll start with that disclaimer. But there was the mid-1800s, about 20 years after the Great Fire in Chicago. Chicago decided to show off all of their rebuilding and everything that had happened in the city. And it was similar to what we would call, like in New York, the World's Fair, where they basically invited the world to see the latest in construction, the latest in big city development, and all the ways that Chicago had recovered from truly what was ashes 20 years prior. And there was a group that met at that time that decided to have all of the world religious leaders that wanted to participate to come and gather. They could come and gather, and they would share their ideas from their religion in terms of what was right about their religion, what was their message from their religion, and then how could maybe they could construct a new religion that took all of the views of those religious perspectives and come up with a new faith that maybe could capture all of the good from all of them, and then that would be the new faith that would move forward. I don't know if Dwight Moody was invited to this meeting, but if he was, he surely turned down the invitation, because rather than figure out how we can make all of the religions in the world make sense and all of them work together all of a sudden, as if, you know, there's many gods that we could make get along, and then all of a sudden they would have this team of salvation and this message of salvation that all of them would be happy with and comply to. As if that could be possible, Dwight Moody's response to that initiative was to rent out empty music halls and rent out theaters and hire and set up gigantic circus tents and commission men to go out on the street corners everywhere to preach the good news of Jesus Christ. And when asked what his focus was or how he intended to confront this idea that all roads lead to God, which I would argue is a truth, they do, just not salvifically. But this idea that all roads lead to God, and then you can just pick one, and whatever one you want to get on, just get on that little train and it'll lead you to God and everything will be fine. They asked how he was going to do it. Are you going to go out, Moody, with and the men that you're sending out to go out and preach this good news, are you sending them out with, you know, apologetics and why that one's wrong and why this one's wrong and why that one's wrong? He's like, you know, I could do that. That could be a very viable way to address the issue of universalism, the lie of universalism. And he says, no, I'm not doing that. We're going to go out and we're going to preach, demonstrate from the word the supremacy, the unique supremacy of Jesus Christ. We're going to let people see that of all the ideas and all the inclinations of man, all the ways that we skew and twist scripture, and all these false messiahs that we've set up and all these false gods that we've set up, I want them to see that that Jesus Christ is incomparable in comparison. That he is supreme, he is unique, and he stands alone as the only viable Savior for lost sinners. And it is reported that thousands heard and repented of their sins and put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ and in him and him alone. And it's like, that is awesome. That is good news. And there are many texts that we can go to throughout Scripture. In fact, Tim just read one of them for us from Philippians that speak to and that testify to the unique supremacy of Jesus Christ and him alone. And that text from Philippians is so beautiful because it's a reminder of Jesus' humility. It's a reminder of the fact that Jesus did something unique, unheard of in all of the ideas of God and all of the manifestations, the way humans have come up with new gods. All these gods never become man and humble themselves into the form of a servant. That would be foolish. I mean, when's the last time you heard of Zeus coming down and serving man. When was the last time that the throne or the altar of Molech actually served you or served man? Never. You always did something at these altars to sacrifice and serve to these gods. And Paul, to the Philippians, does this beautiful thing. He demonstrates, he reveals to them what was going on in Jesus' incarnation to show them the supremacy, the uniqueness, the unparalleled beauty of Jesus. And in Philippians 2, verse 5, that Tim read for us, we have this. He's pointing them to this idea that we have to wrap our minds around this reality. Have this mind among yourselves. And then he goes on to demonstrate what this mindset is. And it's not only something that we can have, it's something that is available to us, he says, which is yours in Christ Jesus. So he's telling them to have something to bring to reality in their thoughts and their minds, something that is actually theirs. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. And then he demonstrates the supremacy and the incomparable beauty of who Jesus is. Verse 6, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. If we had lunch and dinner, I still could not unpack that text in its entirety for us. But that is so beautiful in terms of the humility that Jesus demonstrated by coming to take on human flesh. And there's a purpose for all that he points us to, that who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant. So how did he empty himself? He took the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. He took on flesh, the incarnation, the reality of Emmanuel, that God is with us. Jesus became that reality, that as he took on human flesh to live and ultimately to die, Paul goes on to tell us. Verse 8, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. That's the example of Christ's unique supremacy, his incomparable beauty, in that he humbled himself to take on the form of human flesh, to be human, to be fully human, and to do so, to die, and to be the only one that we could call human that ever didn't deserve to die. Perfectly sinless, perfectly holy, without blemish, without spot, without wrinkle. And he was so obedient to the plan laid before him that he humbled himself to the point of death, even death on a cross. And we think, well, why was the method important? Why would Paul call it the method? Because the cross was a scourge. It was public. It was humiliation at its highest. Your crimes were nailed above your head as you were nailed to the cross so that everyone could walk by and see what they were sacrificed or why they were crucified, why they were punished ultimately. That's why the call for the cross is so important, because it was a public humiliation, it was a public death, plus it was a fulfillment of prophecy, so that Jesus humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross, this terrible, shameful thing. And we know the story doesn't end there, right? Because we're getting ready to go into, in a couple of weeks, celebrating his resurrection, the high point of his ministry, proving that he is the Messiah that we needed. Verse 9, therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And that's a reality. That day will come when every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And so what are we doing now to point people to that reality? Well, part of what we should be doing, and I would say the center, the bullseye of what we should be doing, is pointing them to Jesus, the incomparable Christ, the high and exalted one, the beautiful Savior, who came to earth and humbled himself by taking on human flesh. I mean, you and I only know human flesh as an existence. We only know this existence. Imagine the God of very God, the one, as we'll see from Colossians, is the very instrument and means and sustainer of creation, taking on human flesh. It's unique. It's unparalleled. There's no corollary. There's hardly an analogy that can be made for it that isn't ridiculous. Like, when's the last time a painter became part of his painting? I mean, even tattoo artists still bear their human image. Even if they tattoo themselves, they're still human. Like, it's unparalleled. There's no analogy, there's no train track that we can run next to Christ to actually help us understand the absolute uniqueness of this. He's alone in creation in doing this for us. And he did so for a reason, to die that death that we deserved. And then to defeat that death, to be exalted and highly lifted up and given the name by which all men can be saved. The name of Jesus goes forth as supreme and incomparable. Not one of many. Not spin the wheel of fortune of gods and wherever it lands, you can worship that one and eventually you'll get there. But alone and unique. And Paul has strong basis to make this point, as did Dwight L. Moody 175 years ago. Because Jesus himself made that declaration himself in John 14:6, where it's recorded for us, where he said, "I am the way, and I am the truth, and I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The exclusive gospel of Jesus Christ, the very means by which we get to be saved, is through his death on the cross. It's through that empty cross. It's through that empty tomb. And through the message of his gospel that is truly good news. So that supremacy of Jesus Christ is demonstrated for us there in Philippians 2. And I chose that text because this is often referred to as a hymn. It's a hymn, a Christ hymn that speaks to and magnifies the glory of who God is. It helps us go to one section of Scripture and read in that some of the amazing truths that we can worship God through. The beauty that is demonstrated in those verses. And there's another hymn, and we're going to look at the first three verses of it this morning. And that's captured for us in Colossians 1. And so this morning we're going to hear from Joyce, who read on camera Colossians 1, verses 15 through 17. So, Paul, if you'd like to click through. And it may need one more. There we go.
Colossians 1, 15 through 17. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things consist.
This is the word of the Lord. Thank you, Joyce, for reading that. We've been building, or I should say Paul's been building in this letter to the Colossians, the reality that everything that they have as the church, because we're the church of Jesus Christ, and that everything that this church that he's writing to has is as a result of what Jesus has done for them, whether it was the fulfillment of the promises of the Old Testament or it's the reality of life today and into the day when Jesus returns. It all consists and subsists for Jesus Christ. And Paul's calling as an apostle, verse 1 of chapter 1, was he's called as an apostle of Christ Jesus. And he's writing to saints and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae. And then he's in verse 3, we always thank God the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus. They first heard of it, verse 7, as they learned of it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He's a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf. I mean, over and over again, he's pointing them to the reality that their very existence as a church, their very basis of their salvation is because of Christ Jesus. That he is unique and he is supreme and he is incomparable. And in verse 13, he gives this beautiful picture, this idea that we can almost visualize, that he, God, has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom. And we looked at this last week. And what kingdom? It's the kingdom of his beloved Son. So again, he's reminding them that they are citizens of the kingdom of Jesus Christ. And then what many people believe to be a hymn is beginning here in verse 15 that Joyce read for us. And it is so beautiful because it points us to how incomparable Jesus is in so many beautiful ways. I mean, I hope, and part of my prayer for this morning is that as we picture who Paul is demonstrating and who he's describing for this that church in Colossae, that we as members of this church would visualize Jesus. We would see Jesus for who he is. We would give ample thought to who Jesus is. And that's why I asked Paul earlier in the week, I'm like, man, can we do turn your eyes upon Jesus this week? See, I'm like, the sermon's going to be about all about Jesus. And Paul was like, shouldn't they all be? And I was like, convicted. Thank you, brother. Yes, they should be. We get there eventually sometimes, but boy, let's maybe do a better job of getting to him sooner. But that we can turn our eyes to Jesus, that we can see him for who he is, because Paul isn't writing this so that we have verses to memorize so that we can just rattle them off. He's writing this so that we can see Jesus for who he truly is and how incomparable he is to all of creation, to everything that we know, all of our existence that we know. Jesus stands unique, and it begins in verse 15. Verse 15 reads, he, Jesus, the Son, that's referring back to verse 13, the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption for the forgiveness of sins. He, that Jesus, he is the image of the invisible God. And right there you go, my mind is blown. I mean, through all of Scripture, we rightly read that God is spirit. Even from the creation account, that as God was calling things into existence, the Spirit of God hovered over the waters. You don't have a God you can see. And then we're told elsewhere that no one can see God and live. And that even Moses was just giving a trailing view of the glory of God. He sees just the backside of God's glory as it goes by, not even a full revelation or an unfiltered revelation of who God is. That even as Moses up on the mountaintop could only see and survive just the trailing image of God's glory. Or that beautiful scene in Isaiah 6 that we talk about so much here because it's so important. The holiness of God is on display in that angelic cry of holy, holy, holy. And before that, you read that those angels won't even touch the ground of God's holy place and his round his throne. They hover with one set of wings. With another set of wings, they dare not even look upon God. They cover their eyes with his wings. And with another, they cover their feet, symbolizing the fact that wherever we go, we carry with us the vestiges of this world. That to be in God's presence, to be in his holiness is awesome and powerful. And God rightly remains a spirit for us in creation. We couldn't handle it until he humbles himself and takes on the form of a servant and becomes a revelation of who he is in Jesus Christ in that incarnation, in the Emmanuel moment of God with us. He is the image of the invisible God. And I would argue that first phrase makes us understand that Jesus is incomparable in all of eternity. That he stands alone. There's nothing to compare him with which we could compare him to as the image of the invisible God. He is the image in which that you and I have been made bearers of. And I would make that point from Genesis 1. Genesis 1 gives us a beautiful account of the creation of humankind. Genesis 1, verse 26, then God said, let us make man in our image. I will avoid the pluralities of those pronouns for a moment to keep our eyes focused on what we're going for, but that is a demonstration of the plurality of God, the Trinity, not quite defined as three here, but let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth, which tells me, what is the role of humanity? What are we supposed to have authority over? Everything, yeah. Amen. Over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the heavens, over the livestock. So our job as image bearers is one, we have the distinct and unique quality in all of creation, set apart from all creation, to bear God's image. And if we hold this in unison with what Paul's telling us in Colossians, what image were we to bear? The ruler and the kingdom and the kingship of Jesus. We were to rule for God over the earth. We are his vice regents. We are his ambassadors. We're to rule over creation. Creation was meant to serve us as we and creation together give glory to God. Not in a dictatorial abuse creation sense, but in a sense that we use and have authority over creation for the purpose of multiplying, for the purpose of being fruitful, for the purpose of flourishing, so that in those moments and as we do flourish and as we do multiply, we do so honoring God and glorifying Him. The stars were put in place to glorify God, but they don't bear His image. As magnificent and awe-inspiring as looking out at a night sky can be. I mean, I saw images that were captured just from like Traverse City of how amazing the Northern Lights were two or three nights ago. How amazing and awe-inspiring would that be? But do you understand that you as an image bearer bear more glory to God than that? Or at least we should. And that creation is further defined in verse 27. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, so there's a really big emphasis on image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. I wonder where I could go from this verse. Your chuckles tell me I probably don't even need to go there. But if we give up this verse and the authority of this verse, we are off base from start. We are off base from go. That you bear God's image in the exact way that He has created you. As He knits baby Bailey together in Anna's womb, they get to have a peek inside of that womb this week and maybe see if baby Bailey isn't bashful. That's a tongue twister. Baby Bailey isn't bashful. They will see, did God create their daughter or their son? And existing in that way as God has created them brings God glory. A very basic and simple truth. As we walk and want to give glory to God, we walk in the way that He has created us because He's created us in His image, in His way. And then we see what image were we all, are we all reflecting? What image were we created in? It's the image of Jesus Christ in Colossians. That we were to rule and to rule well for God. We were to be vice regents for God. Because Jesus is the image in which we've all been created. He is the image of the invisible God, which means He is incomparable of all creation. And we have the distinct privilege of reflecting that to the world around us and how we live and how we rule over creation and how we raise our families and how we instruct our children and how we work and how we enjoy hobbies and how we spend our free time. Are you convicted yet? Because I can keep going. But I am, so I'm going to stop. And so Jesus has this role of being the image of God so that we then get to see now what we are to walk in and how we are to rule. He is the image. The word that stands behind that is a Greek word that you guys could all say. It's not one of these Greek words that's hard to say. It's the icon. Boy, I wonder if there's a similar word in our language. And now we get an idea of why icons, or why we define icon in that way. And we start to see that in what God was doing in Jesus Christ was revealing Himself to humanity as the fulfillment of all these promises of the Messiah to come. And in the Gospel of John, we have these amazing truths captured for us, which really run complementary to this hymn in Colossians. And in John 1:1, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So now in John 1, we see that Jesus is God. He's with God. So there's fellowship. There's unity there that's going on. There's distinctness in personhood, but unity. Verse 2, He was in the beginning with God. So He's in the beginning. He's not part of creation. He is, because He is God. But now He's uncreated, we can say, from verse 2. Verse 3, all things were made through Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. So He is the vessel, He is the agent of creation. Verse 4, in Him was life, and the life was the light of men. So now He's the sustainer of all creation. He is life, which He tells us in John 14 as well. And He's the light of men. So mankind starts to see how we can live in this world or how we can relate back to God because of who Jesus is. He enlightens us to these spiritual realities. And what does that light do? Verse 5, the light shines into the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Is there not a verse that makes a stronger contrast to the world today than that? I mean, everywhere we look, if we follow what's being fed to us through means of media and other things we carry in our pockets, you don't see darkness losing. That's not an accident. You don't see darkness losing. That's the message that you really see from the world. Like, either get on darkness's side or get overrun by it. You hateful, insert the blank phobic. But in reality, the spiritual reality is the darkness can't overcome the light. Darkness doesn't exist by itself. It only exists in the absence of light, and we are the light of God. That the church should be the lighthouse on the hill so that we can radiate God's truth and light and healing and transformation for the world around us. And you, as Christians, can shine your light wherever you go. And it's not even your light you're shining Jesus' light. And we have that beautiful promise that the light shines into the darkness, and darkness has not overcome it. That you aren't enough in and of yourself, first of all. But Jesus is, because he's the light. You shine his light, which cannot be overcome by darkness. And jump down to verse 14, because there's an interlude here which introduces John the Baptist. Verse 14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, is really what Paul was exploring in Philippians 2 and the reality that he's showing us in Colossians 1. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, which lets us know right away that he's speaking to Jesus, who he'll introduce in a moment. And we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John, speaking of John the Baptist, John bore witness about him and cried out, "This is he of whom I said, he who comes after me ranks before me, because he was before me." Interesting, because Jesus is technically younger than John by 6 months. And he knows, John the Baptist knew, that Jesus is before him. Verse 16, "For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace." That's the message. That's the light that darkness can't overcome. "For the law was given through Moses, and grace and truth came through Jesus Christ." These two complementary messages of God, which point us to the fact that we need a Savior, and Jesus Christ, the grace and truth, is that Savior. In verse 18, "No one has ever seen God, the only God, who is at his Father's side. Jesus, he has made him known." So when Paul says that he is the image of the invisible God, he is absolutely referring to that human public ministry of Jesus Christ, the very means by which you and I are saved. By taking on human flesh to stand in your place in judgment, because that's what sin demands. R.C. Sproul has famously said, "Sin is cosmic treason against a holy God." How often do I think of that before I fly off the handle? Or before I'm tempted to shade the truth with a little lie? Or I'm tempted to gossip? Or I'm tempted to give in to lust? Or I'm tempted to give in to gluttony? How often do I think of the fact that Jesus died for those sins? He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, then tells us that he is incomparable in all of creation. As the image of the invisible God, he's incomparable in all of eternity. There's nothing like him in all of eternity. Now, if we think of things seen, and he'll get to a moment in things unseen, but for now, the things that are seen through creation, he's the firstborn of all creation. And then we start to say, well, uh-oh, firstborn. Maybe the Arius heresy is right. Maybe Jehovah's Witnesses are right, that Jesus is created, firstborn, it says here. But we have to remember that the word firstborn can be used one of two ways. The first, of course, is birth order. There's a new piece of knowledge for you, right? Firstborn, really? That's birth order? The other way is also rank and honor. I would say John the Baptist was referring to that when he says that Jesus was before me, rank and honor, but also in terms of creation. But I would also argue in 1 Samuel, and you don't have to turn there, but 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 11, the Lord speaks of David. And does, who here knows what order in birth David was of his family? The youngest. So, firstborn? No. The Lord says, I will appoint David firstborn. He was appointing him of a higher rank and worthy of more honor. And I would think also Psalm 89 carries this truth and this idea as well. And I'd like to show you these from Scripture so you don't think that they're just from my imagination, which I'll admit can wander from time to time. But if I can guide it with Scripture. Jesus is absolutely referred to here, maybe not by name, but this is a messianic psalm. It's referring to in many spots about the reality that there is a Messiah to come, and he is the anointed one. He's the one that's going to be the one that's going to be offer salvation. And in Psalm 89, we read in verse 19, I'll pick up in 19 anyways, of old you spoke in a vision to your godly one and said, I have granted help to one who is mighty. I have exalted one chosen from the people. I have found David, my servant, with my holy oil. I have anointed him so that my hand shall be established with him. My arm also shall strengthen him. The enemy shall not outwit him. The wicked shall not humble him. I will crush his foes before him and strike down those who hate him. My faithfulness and my steadfast love shall be with him, and in my name shall his horn be exalted. And I will set his hand on the sea and his right hand on the rivers. He shall cry to me, you are my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation. And I will make him the firstborn. Repeating what we read in 1 Samuel. The highest of the kings of the earth. My steadfast love, I will keep him forever. And my covenant will stand firm for him. And I will establish his offspring forever. And his throne as the days of the heavens. This is why the nation of Israel was waiting for the forever offspring of David to rule forever for eternity from his throne. This is why also we can say from the New Testament that Jesus fulfilled those promises. That Jesus is that long-awaited offspring, the stump of Jesse, the root of Jesse, David's father. That Jesus is then that firstborn that they were waiting for. That Jesus is incomparable throughout all of creation. He's the firstborn. He's the one that ranks above high in honor of all creation. He's the one to whom all glory should be given when we think about our salvation. But then the question becomes, why? Why should all creation give honor to him? And then Paul answers it in verse 16. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. So if Jesus was incomparable in all of creation, this now argues that Jesus is incomparable over all creation. He's the one that has rank and honor above all of creation, the end of verse 15, then 16. Why? Because by him all things were created in heaven and on earth. Now he stands not only outside of all creation as worthy of all honor and praise, now he stands above it as creator and sustainer. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Everything you see that has been created, which should in and of itself be a redundant sentence, everything that we see has been created by Jesus. Everything. It's probably one of my favorite things when I go out hiking. Like, you look around and this happened about 3 weeks ago, and I didn't think I was going to see a lot of water on this particular hike, and a lot of creeks and things aren't on some of the maps I use, and I'm planning out this hike, and I come to this spot where I coming up to a switchback to go down a hill, and at the bottom of the hill is this flowing creek, and there's like little one-foot waterfall, so it's not like Taquamanon or anything like that. But I could just stand there and go, the power of God to create all these things that in this moment where the other thing he created, my body, is hurting, I can look out and just see his creation, his beauty. That was created to give him glory. And then somebody knowing that the human part of his creation is going to struggle at times, they build a footbridge over this creek. is so thankful for that too. But you can just look out and you can see in creation that Jesus has created all of this. Which tells me, if he's king over it all, that we bring the message everywhere we go. Because Jesus is incomparable of all creation. He not only is the means by which everything was created, for by him all things were created. That's a means or that by him could be an agent aspect. He's the agent of all creation. He's the one that God spoke through. He's the word from John 1. He's the one by whom all creation was made. So by him all things were made in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. So even the spiritual realm, even the angels and the fallen angels were created by Jesus. Everything. And this is important because in this letter to the Colossians, we're going to read in chapter 2, that there was a chance or a propensity for some of those in that region, maybe from vestiges of other religions, but there was a chance that they would worship the angels. And here Paul in this beautiful hymn is reminding them, don't. They're part of creation. Don't worship the trees. Don't worship the cows. Don't worship the whales. Rule over them rightly for God's glory. Don't abuse them rightly, but have authority. Use them for flourishing, for multiplying, for enjoying God's beautiful earth. But don't worship them, and that includes the angels. Thankful for the times in Scripture, in particular, I think of the book of Revelation. Don't bow down to me, the angel says. We only bow to Jesus. Or the author of Hebrews, who reminds us that Jesus is over and above the angels. He alone, as he stands incomparable of all creation, he's over all creation, he's different from all creation, but he alone is worthy of that worship. And we don't replace him or we don't substitute him with things from this world. We don't make a bronze calf. In theory or in practice, we worship him. He's incomparable over all of creation. He's supreme over the angels. He's supreme over the angels. He's supreme over those that have thrones. He's supreme over those who have dominion, over those who rule, and over those who have authority. And there's a couple words there that right away in our minds, those four things, we can think of earthly corollaries to that, actual kings and actual rulers. And I believe that's on the table with the second half of those, or the second two anyways. But thrones and dominions very likely refers to the role and rule of angels in their realm. We don't worship those things. We don't worship angels. We don't worship demons. And arguably, those things are on display in many ways today. And rulers and authorities may very likely refer to those that are in authority over us. We don't worship our president. We don't worship our governor. We don't worship senators, congressmen. We don't worship kings. I mean, we're going to have a big time fighting that worship in a couple months when there's a king coronated. And you will see worship. Exaltation. We don't worship them. In fact, they're servants, Romans tells us. They should be. We honor them when they call us to live well, to rule well, and to honor God through their laws and rules. But we best honor God by seeing him as supreme and unique and incomparable and worthy of our worship and praise. And this is a call. And if we think about the original audience that received this, they stand where you have to worship Caesar. Now imagine reading this verse, this letter from Paul. I have to worship Caesar or else, because there's no other God. You can't worship angels, you can't worship spirits, you can't worship those sorts of things. But our world around us kind of does. But if I don't, I will be subject to penalties from Rome. Because we have to keep the Pax Romana, the peace of Rome. Above all else, we have to keep peace. And if the governors over those different regions in that area, if they didn't keep the peace, they were often, demoted. And what I mean by that is beheaded. They ruled for absolute control under the guise of peace. Where is there peace in that? And what did Paul tell his audience prior to this? You have peace with God through Christ Jesus. He stands alone in all rule, authority, thrones, and dominions. He's incomparable, he is supreme, and he is unique. He rules with peace and love and hope, all of it rightly understood. under Christ. So we've seen that Jesus is incomparable in all eternity. We've seen that Jesus is incomparable in all creation, and he's incomparable over all creation. And now we're going to see that Jesus is incomparable over all eternity. Verse 17, and he, Jesus, is before all things, echoing John 1, echoing the realities of Genesis 1. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. That Jesus is the one that is pre-existent. He exists before time. He's not a product of time. He's not a creation. He's not part of creation. He is creation. He is the one who created everything. You can't create everything if you are part of creation, because now you're created. How did you get created? Redundancy with no end. Jesus is pre-existent. He's part of the counsel of God. We know that. He's before all things, and in him all things hold together, which means he is sustainer. He holds all things together. The very reason why everything hasn't unraveled, even though sometimes we like to believe it has, is because he holds all things together. Even this moment in this time, even this time in our lives as we see a society crumbling around us morally and ethically, he holds all of that together. And why? He's giving hope for repentance, that people will hear the good news, turn from their sins, and trust in his finished work. He doesn't sustain all creation so that everything can just continue to get worse and we can lament that fact. He creates it and he sustains it so that there is hope for others to come to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. And not a voice among many, but the singular clarion call of Jesus Christ, the name by which all creation will give honor to him at one day when every knee will bow and honor him by declaring that he is Lord. And knees will either bend on that day or be bent on that day. Saying that gives me a chill. I don't say that lightly, which means our job is to be agents of that gospel message, to share it, to warn. The nicest thing you can do for a child that's in a street with a truck bearing down on them is not like, hey, you look really nice today. Are those new shoes? Get out of the street. Run. Save them. Why do we treat the gospel as anything else? May it season everything we do. How we live, how we work, how we interact. May we speak the truth in love. I've referred to this a couple times, and maybe you're tired of the illustration, but I think it bears importance, at least in our culture that we live in today. But there's a noted Satan worship, essentially, part of the magician troupe Penn and Teller, the tall one, I don't remember his name, who wondered why every Christian he meets hasn't warned him of the realities of hell. He says, I have a hard time trusting and adhering to a faith that demonstrates they don't believe what they believe. So thankful Ray Comfort took him up on that offer and has met with him on a number of occasions. So at when his knee bows, whether bent or bending, he will not be able to say, I didn't hear or I didn't know. Who's that person in your life that you can share Christ with today, tomorrow? The next time the table is filled with family members and friends and neighbors. Maybe it's in the mirror in the morning. And you wake up and you can remind yourself that you're a child of the King. That through all of time and eternity, he reached down and saved you. And you can live as if that's real and true. Jesus has set himself up, and Paul then recognizes that and shares this beautiful truth that he's incomparable amongst all of creation. He is the image of the invisible God. He is the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. That everything we have, will have, everything we do, will do, as a result of his sustenance, his provisions. If you're in your Bibles still in Colossians, you can flip forward to the book of Hebrews. The author of Hebrews does a really wonderful job of expanding on some of these similar thoughts. And in regards to where I want to go in chapter 9, this helps us understand the way this truth, the truths of Colossians 1, 15 through 17, can help us live our lives today. In chapter 9, the author of Hebrews is building this case for Jesus being essentially that holy place, that Jesus is the one who fulfills those Old Testament covenants, that Old Testament law, and that ushers in this new covenant of grace that we now exist under today, the completion to which that covenant was pointing. He talks about the priests and the fact that priests live and die, but Jesus Christ is the holy, perfect priest, the high priest that doesn't die, and the one who offers his blood, which is far superior to that of the blood of goats and bulls. And then verse 11, but when Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things that have come, then through the greater and more perfect tent, think tabernacle language, the first iteration of God's temple, not made with hands, that is not of this creation, he entered once for all into the holy places. Not by means of the blood of goats and calves, but by means of his own blood, thus securing an eternal redemption. He took on flesh. He put himself in a tent, so to speak, so that that tent could be rendered from top to bottom, and that he, by his own blood, could secure an eternal redemption. Have assurance in what Christ has done for you, dear brother or sister in the Lord. Especially those of you that are wavering, those of you that are a bruised reed or a smoldering wick. Have assurance in what Jesus has done for you. He has secured an eternal redemption for you. That word eternal is significant. It means a really long time that doesn't end. He has secured that. If you ask an adherent of nearly any other faith, are you sure that you are saved? Or are you sure that you're going to nirvana, utopia, heaven, whatever, paradise, whatever? I don't know, if they're being honest. The Islamic people who were flying planes into buildings 20 some odd years ago did not know if that act of righteousness, if that act of sacrifice was enough to cover their sins, to get them into paradise. Let that weigh on your heart. Because Jesus has done the exact opposite. He is the sacrifice. He is the full satisfaction for everything you need for salvation. He doesn't give you an 80% off coupon and say, I got this, but you do that. Full and complete, paid for. He has secured an eternal redemption. You are redeemed by his finished, perfect work on the cross. And that effect isn't just for that moment in time when you stand before God, bending your knee and praising God and glorifying God as the Lord and Savior of all. It has an effect for your life today. Verse 13, for if the blood of goats and bulls and the sprinkling of defiled persons with the ashes of a heifer, if that could sanctify for the purification of the flesh, how much more? Essentially, is saying it's so ridiculous, I can't even explain it. There's no way you can enumerate how much more. How much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God. You don't have dead works so that you're working so that you can earn salvation or you can offer God something in like, I owe you this, God, and maybe this will help make sure I'm saved. No, we do work hard. We do serve the Lord because we're saved. Because you are sanctified and being sanctified. Because he's working with you day in and day out for his glory. Why? Because you're distinct from all creation. The stars just have to reflect light. You know, a whale just has to swim in the ocean. A deer just has to come near my stand, broadside, to bring glory to God. 10 point at least. You bring honor to God when you submit to Christ's lordship as your master, as your king, as your savior, as your friend, as your co-heir of grace. That's how you bring honor and glory to God, by repenting of your sins and turning and trusting him and then walking in newness of life each and every day. Each and every day fighting sin, putting on Christ all the more, but knowing that in your fight with sin, that you're redeemed and you have his hope and you have him as a refuge, that you are sustained today because of him, and that your very salvation is due entirely because of him. Jesus Christ stands incomparable in and over eternity and in and over creation, and that includes you as his image bearer. Live for him today and always. Let's pray.